Let me tell you what this Game Boy and this microcontroller boards both have in common. Their main control chip is based on digital electronics, meaning all information are stored as either a binary 1 or 0. And all the chip basically does is shifting the 1s and 0s from and to other registers to fulfill more complex functions, like for example playing Pokemon. But while playing back in the days, it always felt like the game speed was a bit too slow. And luckily, nowadays, I'm aware of a solution to increase the speed, which is called overclocking. So in this video, let me briefly explain what overclocking is, how we can use it with a microcontroller to actually make it more useful, and finally explore the circuitry of my Game Boy to find out what the maximum overclocking limit is. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by Altium, who offer probably the most professional PCB designer software on the market. It comes with all the functions you could ever need when it comes to not only designing a simple and quick PCB, but also a very complex and demanding one. And best of all, you can try their software out for free by clicking the link in the video description. So why not give it a shot? First off, let's answer the question what overclocking is. As stated before, a Game Boy or microcontroller works by moving around 1s and 0s, which, electrically speaking, is a high or low voltage signal. But how do they know when exactly they have to move the bits around, and thus keeping all parts of the system in sync? Well, for that, digital electronics pretty much always come with a clock signal, which is basically a voltage signal with a defined frequency and two threshold values that tell the system when it is time to move on to the next bit. To understand this theory a bit better, we can have a look at a practical component that generates such a clock signal, which is this 4-pin oscillator. According to its datasheet, it only requires 5 volts and ground applied to it, in order to spit out our desired signal. So let's do just that with the help of my lab bench power supply, and have a look at the output on the oscilloscope. As you can see, we got a square wave whose on and off time is about the same, and whose frequency is spot on 8 MHz, definitely suitable as a clock signal. Now with a frequency of 8 MHz, it means that our digital electronic system moves new bits around every 125 nanoseconds. And thus, it obviously can do a total of 8 million of them in a second. And I think at this point it should be very clear how to speed things up, by simply increasing this clock frequency, and thus letting the system do more tasks per second. Of course, all of this is not recommended by the manufacturer, because with a higher clock frequency, these semiconductors have more to do in a second and thus requiring more current, which can make things unstable and eventually even destroy everything. But I guess this is what I want to find out. So, as a first example, I got my trusty Arduino Nano here, which I often like to use to generate a high frequency PWM signal whose duty cycle I can fine adjust. Such voltage signals are suitable when it comes to, for example, building switch mode power supplies. But there is one big problem with my Arduino, which is the reason why I actually used this teensy microcontroller so far for this particular power supply I built during a previous video. By doing a bit of very simple teensy programming, we can set its frequency easily to 100 kHz, while still being able to fine adjust the duty cycle in 256 steps, aka 8 bits. The Arduino programming, on the other hand, is not only a bit harder to do, but even by setting the timer to its optimal settings, we can only reach a frequency of 62.5 kHz, while achieving a resolution of once again 8 bits. So the problem is simply that my power supply design needs a switching frequency that the Teensy can deliver, but not the Arduino. Yet. Responsible for the clock signal of the Arduino is this small part right next to the microcontroller, that apparently comes with 3 pins. So I did the most sensible thing by probing those 3 pins while the Arduino was running, and it seems like the middle one is ground, while the other two feature a sine voltage with a frequency of 16 MHz. And yes, this sine voltage is this time our clock signal. And it is the sine voltage because it not only introduces less noise into our system, but also because we are dealing with a crystal oscillator here. In comparison to the square wave oscillator we had a look at before, which utilizes mostly discrete components, a crystal oscillator is basically a piezo element whose mechanical resonance frequency we take advantage of. Thus, by building up a kind of electrical resonance circuit, the crystal oscillates, and thus helps us creating the clock signal, which, due to the nature of resonance, comes as a sine wave. And since we know that the clock frequency is 16 MHz, we can divide 60 million by the 256 8-bit steps to calculate the max PWM frequency, which is of course the same as we measured. So according to the math, we would need a clock signal of 25.6 MHz to get a 100 kHz PWM signal, which we can surely try out by simply removing the crystal from the board, soldering a wire to the middle and top connection point, and hooking them up to ground and the output of my waveform generator. As you can see, by creating a similar 16 MHz sine wave, the Arduino still works the same way as it did before. But by, for example, decreasing the frequency to half of that, the PWM frequency also gets halved, which proves that my waveform generator clock signal actually works. And fun fact, the current draw dropped from 20 mA at 16 MHz to 60 mA at 8 MHz, and the lowest clock frequency I was able to use in a somewhat stable manner was around 1 kHz at a current draw of 12 mA. But enough with playing around, because it was time to crank up the frequency. And as you can see, at around 25.6 MHz, the system still worked perfectly fine while delivering a 100 kHz PWM signal. So I tried even higher frequencies, and the limit I reached was at around 40 MHz, at which point the Arduino did not run stable anymore and glitched around. In conclusion, a 100 kHz PWM signal with 8-bit resolution is easily achievable with an Arduino, and we should look out for glitches in the next GameBoy tests which signalize that we are reaching the overclocking limits. So time to unpack my tri-ring screwdriver and start removing every screw I found in the enclosure of my GameBoy. And after a couple of minutes I was in, and next had a closer look at all the ICs and components. Now in my opinion, this component might create our clock signal, because the printed on label of 8.388 can very easily stand for the megahertz value. So I powered the GameBoy with my LabBench power supply and probed all the pins of the components. It seems like we are truly working with an 8.4 MHz clock signal. And by further finding out that there are only two slightly different signals distributed across all pins, it seems like we are looking at a crystal oscillator. But to apply my own altered signal, I obviously had to somehow remove it, which was possible with a bit of hot air and patience. And as you can see, we truly only got two pins, to which I soldered extension wires next to do the upcoming testing more easily. Now of course at this point we could get ourselves such a crystal oscillator kit with a variety of frequencies that we could simply swap between for the limit testing. But I like the fine adjustment of my waveform generator, which is why I hooked it up to the ground of the GameBoy and this time the lower pin. And as you can see, it worked just fine. Once again, it was quite funny to decrease the clock frequency in order to find out how the game looks and sounds in slow motion mode. But as before, going up was my goal, and I'm happy to report that twice the frequency of 60 MHz was not a problem for the GameBoy, which is actually a great speed to get through the game quickly. Best of all, there are 16 MHz crystals everywhere, so a simple mod like this with a switch and two crystals as modes is certainly possible. But anyway, I wanted to see the limits, and that seems to be just above 20 MHz, at which point the music glitched and the display turned off, which basically concludes my experiments. So I restored the functionality of my GameBoy, because it is a bit precious to me. And I hope you maybe learned something through this video while hopefully being entertained. If so, consider supporting me through Patreon so that I can keep producing videos. As always, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!